One-on-One with Jane Mitchell, featuring the legends.
Dave Winfield is a legend. His performance, presence, and personality made for a powerful combination as a player and earned him his place in the National Baseball Hall of Fame, the first player to enter as a San Diego Padre. He was also inducted into San Diego's Breitbart Hall of Fame back in 1998 and spent more than a decade involved with the Padres and the city where he started his career. We will hear how his commitment to the history and the future of the game has evolved, but we begin by returning to a magical week in New York, the summer of 2001.
You think about it, but it's almost mythical. There's no reason to think you're on the Hall of Fame or even make it to the major leagues or even be an all-star or do anything special. It was just, I was playing baseball.
As chairman of the National Baseball Hall of Fame, it is my honor, Dave, to welcome you into our Hall of Fame family.
I had my choice to be a tight end for the Minnesota Vikings, a power forward for the Atlanta Hawks or Utah Stars, or to play baseball, Major League Baseball. And I remember the scout, Donnie Williams, after they drafted, he was with the Padres. I asked him, I said, Donnie, what do you want me to do? He said, man, we want you to play every day. We want you to hit that ball and run. And so the rest is history. I chose baseball because to me, baseball is the best game of all.
His passion for the game would take him to the top. His classmates, one-time teammate, Minnesota Twin and stocky center fielder Kirby Puckett, whose playing career was cut short by glaucoma. The Pirates' Bill Mazeroski, arguably the best defensive second baseman ever, who, after 30 years, was finally voted in by the Veterans Committee. And the late Hilton Smith, the right-handed pitcher who played in the shadows of the great Satchel Paige in the Negro Leagues. Getting into the hall is a long and unlikely road, considering the odds.
Right here!
Of the 3 million youngsters playing Little League, only a small percentage will ever be good enough to play in college or be drafted into the minor leagues.
Of those, 5% will ever play in a single major league game. Those who make it to the major leagues are the best of the best. And only 1 out of 100 of those players, 1% of the best, is inducted into the Baseball Hall of Fame here in Cooperstown.
It is also a challenge to get here, considering the logistics. Cooperstown is a 4-hour drive northwest of New York City, or an hour and a half drive south of Albany's airport, through dairy and farmland, on a 2-lane road, past thick pine forests, and in the summer, lush green trees, with leaves that rustle in the warm breeze, lining the long Lake Otsego, dotted with lily pads and swans. Streets named Pioneer and Pine, with 19th century homes, lead to Maine, where, even with modern amenities, time seems to stand still. With the flagpole as the town compass, visitors mark the day's extra innings at the Doubleday Cafe, wander by Where It All Began, or marvel over memorabilia at Mickey's Place.
It's just the excitement of meeting the ball players and, you know, seeing the old timers who used to play when I was a kid.
It's the people that played back then who set the example for today.
The brick walls and the arched gallery are the setting for baseball's crown jewels, the plaques of those selected into perhaps the most elite fraternity in professional sports. 40 returned for this annual induction weekend, staying at the historic and majestic Otisaga Hotel by the Leatherstocking Golf Course. Gracious, they share wisdom about the Hall, the game, and Dave Winfield's qualities that placed him in the Hall the first year he was eligible.
I'm just proud of what he's accomplished, and I'm just happy that I had a little bit to do, you know, with it, and I'm happy that he's recognized me as being one of his mentors.
Yeah, I think everyone realized that if this guy stays healthy and he doesn't have any problems throughout his career, you know, he's going to end up in Cooperstown. It was just a matter of when he wanted to quit playing baseball and wait for 5 years, and he's in.
I saw him when I went to San Diego in 1977, when I first saw him play. He was one heck of a ball player. He had a cannon from right field, and you know, he could run down any balls out in the gap and could hit a long home run too. So he's certainly deserving of coming into the Hall of Fame.
I was playing third base, and there was a situation where there was a runner on third and one out, and Dave Winfield came up and he hit a line drive, and to this day I don't know if I dove out of the way of the ball or if I tried to catch it. That's the fear that he could put in a third baseman.
Tremendous athlete and a great competitor, and one of the things I always appreciated about him was that he took the time, because he learned how to play right, he took the time to make sure young players learned how to play the game right. And I think we need that thread to continue through baseball. So not only a good player, but a good guy.
I'm glad to see Dave. He's a Padre by nature. No matter whatever uniform he put on, he's still a Padre. And so he's a guy who's one of those five-fold players that came along who could do everything.
I finally got in 85, and I haven't missed. And I'll be here as long as I live. If I can get here, I'll be here. Because I think going into the Hall of Fame is one of the greatest things there is for a baseball player.
Induction weekend is the most glorious of the year for Cooperstown, as the village of 2,000 swells tenfold, with baseball fans from around the country declaring their team loyalty.
Go Dave Winfield.
Yep. Yes.
They collect autographs and pay homage to living legends who come back each year. Fans also celebrate the new inductees, including Dave Winfield, who they feared or cheered throughout his 22-year career with six teams.
Very aggressive player, great arm, great all-around player. One of the better all-around players of his generation.
He had a tremendous amount of talent as a ball player, and he's a gentleman. He's a good guy, too.
I remember growing up, going to Shea Stadium, and seeing him hit two home runs off of Jerry Kuzman. I mean, he was young, and he was powerful, and he was a stud.
Dave was playing for the Yankees, and we were fortunate enough to be close enough to the dugout. And as he was coming off the field, we did get him to respond and wave to us, and I did get a photo of him. So I have it in my family album, and it's very precious to us, and we're here because of him.
Always laughing, always friendly. Even when he played against the Blue Jays for the Yankees, I always respected him, the way he carried himself on the field.
I'm so glad that he came in to Cooperstown wearing that Padres cap, because it means so much to the team and to the community of San Diego.
For every person honored with a bronze plaque in Cooperstown, there is a story of how it all began, with details that make the earning of such an honor even sweeter. The details of Dave Winfield's story are next on One on One. When considering who is worthy of being elected into the National Baseball Hall of Fame, baseball writers consider a player's ability, performance, character, and overall contribution to the game. But Dave Winfield didn't set out in search of the game's highest honor or to become a legend. He just wanted to play.
Dave Winfield, in baseball terms, was a five-tool ball player. He could run, hit with power, field, and throw. He was also a controversial player, chastised and celebrated, embattled and embraced during his 22 years in the big leagues. He's done it all, just about, and he's done it his way.
I never had limitations on what I thought I could do.
His confidence stems from his upbringing. Born David Mark Winfield in St. Paul, Minnesota, October 3, 1951. His parents divorced when he was three, and while he later became close to his father, his mother and nearby relatives raised him.
Grandmother, aunts, cousins.
His older brother, Steve, was his best friend.
I think we live, sleep, ate, breathe baseball.
The neighborhood Field of Dreams, Oxford Playground, was headed up by a Marine turned Little League coach who would make a lasting impression.
Discipline, you know, was important, not just do what you want to do.
While Winfield, who was always a pitcher, had athletic ability,
I was thin, gangly.
He struggled during awkward growth spurts.
It seemed like I would be banging into things. I have long arms and long legs.
He grew into his body and learned to play the game he had come to love by watching his hometown team, the Minnesota Twins.
We didn't get to that many games because we didn't have enough money.
By high school, he was a star in basketball and baseball. And when Baltimore drafted him as a pitcher, he had a choice.
Getting a scholarship for a major college and get your education to carry you throughout life, or take $500 in a bus ride to Bluefield, West Virginia. It wasn't much of a choice.
He flourished at the University of Minnesota.
I thought I was a good baseball player, and yeah, there was a little cockiness involved in it too, but not overbearing. You go to an American Legion tournament and you tell somebody that, you heard of Dave Winfield? No, I said, well, you will when this is over.
He made history by being the first athlete to be drafted in three professional sports: football with the Minnesota Vikings, though he'd never played the game, basketball with Atlanta and Utah, and baseball. One day, he's the MVP pitching in the 1973 College World Series, and a week later,
I'm playing left field occasionally for the San Diego Padres.
No minor league stopover, just straight to the show.
Number 31.
And all of a sudden, you have to learn to play the outfield. I was bad. I was horrendous. Stumbling, tripping. Guys hit the ball hard and far.
Soon known as Daddy Longlegs, number 31 vividly recalls his first defensive play on a ball certain to be a double.
I scooped it up, fired a bullet to second, and was waiting for the guy. He was out. I said, yeah. I said, it's not so bad. But I had a whole lot to learn.
He gravitated towards veterans Nate Colbert, Willie McCovey, and Cito Gaston.
We'd travel on the planes, that's who I'd be with. I'd sit in the dugout, that's who I'd talk to.
And he implemented what he calls industrial espionage.
You know, I'd send people to ask other people questions on teams. How do you get that Winfield guy out? What are you doing to him? Oh, yeah.
He became an offensive star, near the top in almost every category, making his first of 12 All-Star teams in 1977 and receiving a standing ovation when he signed a $1.3 million four-year deal.
I'd smile and laugh, and I couldn't think of anything more exhilarating. Men on base and hit a triple, show your speed, clear the bases, hook slide into third and sit there like, yeah. And the fans were all on their feet. I get excited about it now.
He was also excited about helping kids.
I knew the athletes could influence a lot of people in a positive way. And I just tried to create the format.
The format, the David Winfield Foundation, the first of its kind in Major League Baseball. Thousands of children benefited from scholarships and were treated to parties and ball games, sitting in the right field bleachers, the Winfield Pavilion, all based on a simple phrase his mother used: give a little when you have a little, give a lot when you have a lot.
It started in my family. That's just the way I was. And so I always gave back.
But with the cheers came jeers. The year is 1980. Winfield is negotiating his next Padres contract and asking for a $20 million 10-year deal, or he'd become a free agent.
Free agent, man, they want to kill. They want to... My car was marked up, garbage was thrown in my yard, and eggs on the house.
The Padres passed.
We don't have the money.
We've basically been unable to come to any kind of conclusion, which is satisfactory to me.
I was the top guy on the market at the time, so I was going to go for it.
Signing with the Yankees made headlines, and owner George Steinbrenner made Dave Winfield the $23 million man, setting a new standard.
People said, you gotta be careful, man. It can get crazy in New York. I said, I don't cause any problems. I'm not worried. For 9 years, that was something.
The drama was well documented in the media. Steinbrenner hoped Winfield would fill the shoes of Reggie Jackson. But when Winfield went 1-for-22 against Los Angeles in the 1981 World Series, Steinbrenner soured on him and things got ugly. Financial and legal disputes personal jousting.
Okay, you're battling with money, I got some money too. You got some lawyers, I got lawyers too. You got PR people, I got PR people.
The nitty-gritty details from Winfield's perspective are laid out in his 1988 book, A Player's Life, which Steinbrenner blasted. Nevertheless, Winfield was popular with the fans. He ranks among the Yankees' all-time top 20 in home runs, doubles, and runs batted in. And among his stats, the notorious Seagull incident. In Toronto, a seagull was sitting on the field near the ball boy.
I threw it in that direction, it short hopped him, bam, splat.
And after the game, Winfield was arrested on cruelty to animals charges.
They got Exhibit A on the table, feet sticking up in the air.
And despite some teasing around the league,
flapping their arms out in center field,
Toronto gave him a commemorative bird and forgave him when he helped the city with a charity event.
Sorry about the animal. I didn't do it on purpose, yes.
His good intentions include expanding his foundation, and from the clubhouse to the White House, shared his message to kids to stay off drugs. His good looks, good works, and style have been recognized in print and on national TV.
You ain't got a thing if you ain't got that swing.
After 8 years in the Bronx Zoo, Winfield sat out 1989, recovering from back surgery. In early 1990, the last year of his contract, he negotiated a trade to a team and owner he felt wanted him. Gene Autry's California Angels.
Is he thrilled? It's a triple. Dave Winfield hits for the cycle.
1992, he played for his former Padre mentor, Cito Gaston, with the Toronto Blue Jays. And the 40-year-old Winfield got a second chance to make a difference in a World Series. In Game 6 against Atlanta, he hit an 11th-inning double that gave the Jays the lead.
It's a two-run double for Dave Winfield.
And they hung on for it all.
For the first time in history, the World Championship banner will fly north of the border.
To be on the best team in baseball, in Major League Baseball, that's a thrill. Man.
In 1993, he went home to the Minnesota Twins and achieved baseball immortality. Delivering hit number 3,000. He could have retired after Minnesota in 94, but with a strike and no World Series that year, people were disenchanted with baseball.
That's really a way for people to forget about you. So I said, I'm going to come back for one more.
But after not playing as much as he wanted to with Cleveland in 95, he retired without the chance to say goodbye to guys around the league.
One of the other regrets. Serious one there.
The transition, not always easy.
You're used to the accolades. You're used to people doing things for you.
Dave Winfield, the businessman, managed his 22-year-old foundation and continues to be involved in charity work. He had a stint as a broadcaster.
Dave Winfield and Steve Lyons. Guys,
but realized he preferred to control his schedule, to be home with his family, his wife Tanya, and their twins, Ariel and David Jr.
See if you can hit it in the swimming pool in Colorado. Here it comes.
Woo! You did it, David!
They're beautiful and they're great, and if we can invest our time in the children,
yeah,
and you know,
yeah,
their school and their community, you know, who knows? Dad might be a little league coach or something after a while or something.
Dave and Tanya met through friends when he was with the Yankees. She wasn't a baseball fan, but she was a top corporate sales executive in Los Angeles.
After our first date, I knew. He didn't talk about himself. He was more interested in what I was doing in my career. I said, I'm not ready for this, but wow. You know?
Their bi-coastal relationship evolved to marriage in 88. Life in L.A. includes moving into a new home.
You guys are seeing history. I haven't opened it since...
Since he received it after the 92 World Series.
Voila.
He's achieved great things in the game. More than 3,000 hits, 465 home runs, 7 gold gloves, 6 silver bats. He's been inducted into San Diego's Breitbart Hall of Fame.
One of the great baseball stars in the last 50 years, Dave Winfield.
And when it was suggested prior to the election that entry into baseball's Hall of Fame was inevitable, he was modest but thrilled at the possibility.
If it happens, that'd be great. It'd be great. I can't tell you any other words. It'd be great.
Dave Winfield's numbers and career would indeed be remarkable, enough to be recognized among the greats. That honor brings new challenges, choosing which team's cap to wear, handling the emotionally consuming countdown to Cooperstown and the biggest public speaking engagement of his life. All that when One on One returns. One can only imagine the awesome sense of accomplishment and perhaps humility that comes with the honor of knowing your name and numbers will live in baseball eternity. The very real and surreal experience surrounding Dave Winfield's induction spotlighted his confidence, courage, and charisma on a whole new stage.
January 2001, 5 years after retiring as a player, Dave Winfield is eligible for the Hall of Fame, but there are no guarantees.
You're waiting, you have butterflies.
With a record 515 ballots cast by members of the Baseball Writers Association of America, he receives a resounding 435, 84%, well above the 75% required. And at his Los Angeles home, the call finally comes.
I had a speakerphone and I was holding my daughter. I pressed it one time and I actually pressed it again. I hung up. And I know it was Jack O'Connell, the sports writer, because he called right back. Hello?
You've been elected to the Hall of Fame, David.
Man, thank you. It was the stamp of approval. He had a great career, so I was ecstatic.
As an inductee, Winfield's early perks are quite presidential. Among the Hall of Famers invited to the White House by President George W. Bush.
One of the great things about living here is you don't have to sign up for a baseball fantasy camp to meet your heroes. Turns out they come here.
It was a beautiful experience.
Early spring, he must make a decision. Which logo will adorn the cap on his Hall of Fame plaque? With much of his career split between two teams, 8 years with the Padres, 10 years with the Yankees, he chooses San Diego.
You gave me my first chance. I got my first hit, first homer, first RBI, first win, all of that. And you never know how much I appreciate that.
While three former Padres, Willie McCovey, Gaylord Perry, and Raleigh Fingers are in the hall, Winfield's April decision would make him the first to enter as a Padre. The news coincides with the retiring of his number, 31, before thousands of fans wearing replica jersey t-shirts.
I'm looking forward to going into the Hall of Fame, wearing a Padre hat proudly.
In May, he had the opportunity to fully explore the Hall of Fame.
Ah, look at that one. Oh man, can I touch this? I mean, this is 100 years old, and Babe Ruth did this, and look at those gloves. No wonder guys hit for great averages, you know? That was cool, Pop?
Yeah.
I got a chance to know him.
Yeah, he's amazing, wasn't he?
Yeah. You emerge once you visit it with a lot more respect, and in my case, reverence, because I played the game and not just looked at it from afar.
The countdown to Cooperstown requires juggling public appearances, working with a Major League Baseball productions crew, documenting many events along the way.
Hold on. That are going to blah, 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 and blah, blah, blah. The Hall of Fame, and they're going to have their moment in the sun, too.
And planning his speech.
I wrote my own words, what I wanted to say. I got input from different people as to what would the people want to hear. And I watched videotapes of some people who had given presentations, knew their timing. Some people were like from 7 to 17 minutes.
Intertwine that with anxious family and friends from coast to coast.
And everybody says, how do I get there? What do I do? I need transportation. What are the logistics?
Thursday, August 2nd.
We got on the plane.
We are so excited.
You should be.
And John Morris is very gracious. Just said, you guys, let's get on my plane. Let's go up to Cooperstown. So we jumped on Nice Jet. And my family, we all had our cameras and videotape. So everything leading up to it, we captured every moment we could because we wanted to savor this.
He's greeted at the hotel's gate by a handful of diehard fans.
Congratulations, Leah.
We'll see you
guys.
Thank you,
David. You're a class act. Thank you.
And with special access for the weekend, our cameras are there for his arrival.
Hey, there he is.
How are you?
Oh, man, good to see you. Oh, man, we made it.
How's your stomach feeling?
No, I'm fine. I'm fine right now. We're just going to relax a little bit and just get ready for the activity this weekend.
That's right.
How are you feeling at
this
moment?
Great. Just to get on that plane and get here and see Cooperstown again, you know, you get the butterflies again. So we're excited about the whole weekend.
Kirby Puckett arrives at the same time.
Big Daddy.
Big Daddy.
I see you.
All right, long time no see.
That's right, all 2 days, huh?
That's right.
All right. That's right.
Yogi Berra and Tommy Lasorda are quick to manage the rookie.
We put a clock up.
Okay.
Here's ring.
Well, I'm telling him to be careful because these old-time Hall of Famers, they're going to start on him right now, him and Kirby Puckett, about no long speeches.
Mr. Berra, how about you? What's your advice to Mr. Winfield?
Same thing. He better make it short.
Or what? Or what?
He get the gong. We're going to put a gong.
When your old manager tells you the time is up, time is up.
There's little sleep for the inductee to be.
Like ahead in this half hour, we're going to talk with Dave Winfield, who's going to be inducted in the baseball's Hall of Fame.
It's going to be beautiful.
7:30 a.m., lights, makeup, a national TV interview from the hotel porch.
And you were a pitcher back then.
Oh, yeah. I mean, the Padres, when they drafted me, had their
choice. I said, what do you want me to do, pitch or play every day?
And another to send home to San Diego.
I feel very comfortable and good about choosing San Diego.
A spontaneous Winfield family stroll down Main Street attracts a friendly crowd.
Look this way first.
Friday evening, a sense of celebration emerges with VIPs on the veranda. Saturday morning, it's back to the old competitive ways on the links. His foursome includes friend Jimmy Jam, a music producer and fellow Minnesotan. He and his colleagues are interviewed by the national media.
I want to be 6'6 like Winnie.
Including some writers who helped elect them to the Hall.
Oh, gee. I mean, he's a guy you don't have to think about. I mean, 3,000 hits, gold gloves, tremendous athlete.
He went to the All-Star game every year, so you knew that his peers and the fans all thought of him as a great player.
Later,
Dave Winfield!
With spotlights and applause, the greats and their guests gather in the Hall of Fame gallery in all its glory.
Give it good luck, because that's where they're going to put a plaque for your daddy.
Then, in the quiet of his hotel room, he prepares what he'll wear for the big moment.
It's the style and the way it fits the body. Bam! You know.
Sunday, August 5th, Induction Day is here.
How you guys doing? All right.
Winfield and the Hall of Famers travel a mile from the hall to a field with 20,000 spectators in front of a tented stage.
It's the Hammer. Henry Aaron is back with us this year. Number 24, the Say Hey Kid, Willie Mays.
A lot of eyes are on you.
The great Yogi Berra, Reggie Jackson. Mr. October, Bob Feller, Willie McCovey.
It's just getting closer to that time, the countdown.
It's number 20, Don Sutton, George Brett, Lou Brock, Sandy Koufax.
You're sweating bullets. You sweat, because it's hot, I ain't lying.
As it once was for others who have gone before him, Babe Ruth.
25 years ago yesterday, I pitched my first baseball game in Boston. Boston Red Sox.
Ted Williams.
There are plaques dedicated to baseball men of all generations, and I'm privileged to join them.
And Hank Aaron.
The way to fame is like the way to heaven, through much tribulations.
It is his turn.
Thank you, Commissioner. Thank you, everybody.
When you're standing at that podium and looking out, what are you seeing?
I see my enclave of people, my family. And they're proud, you know. I see some Padre hats, and you know, I saw Yankee hats, and I saw a couple angel hats. You know, every team that I played for, I saw some representation, and then it keeps going and going, you know.
In the pasture, among those who have made the pilgrimage for this day, is a group of San Diegans wearing those replica jerseys.
Our whole baseball team came, and they're here to support him.
It's overwhelming. It's awesome. I can't explain it.
I look back. There are a few people that I have to tell you about.
His retrospective includes thanking people he never met.
His legend and his saga and his story is just that, Jackie Robinson. We all have to tip our hat to him because he made the game available to guys like me.
And pointing out the importance of having heroes.
You know, heroes are ordinary people that have achieved extraordinary things in life. Guys like Bob Feller and Ted Williams. You know, we're talking about real heroes, and there's many guys, not only just from the way they played the game of baseball, but how would you like to go off to war? You're in the middle of your career, go off to war, come back, get injured, things like that, and still come back and love this game and play it well. Those are real heroes.
He is appreciative of coaches, executives, and owners, including the late owner of the Padres and McDonald's founder, Ray Kroc.
We talk business many times, and his belief in and quality and service fit me like a glove. And that's what I brought to baseball, and that's how I conducted myself throughout my life. That's what that was about. To George Steinbrenner, I want to thank you for bringing me to the New York Yankees. I'm serious. This is an experience that changed my life forever in a positive way. You know, and I'm glad that time, distance, respect, and clear minds has brought about a respect and friendship that we didn't have early on, and I'm glad we have it today.
And to then Padres owner John Moores and President Larry Lucchino.
I appreciate you guys making it very open and very wonderful for me and my family, letting us know that the tradition, you know, me being in San Diego was very important. I appreciate what you've given. Thank you, John. I have to thank all the people that came from San Diego and hopefully the thousands that are back in Qualcomm Stadium in San Diego watching on the Jumbotron this ceremony here. Love goes out to you and thank you for your support.
He acknowledges his late parents, his friends, and confidants.
Randy Grossman, for your youth, energy, skill, and professionalism.
And his brother, Steve.
This is my brother, my best friend in life, baseball playing buddy. And last but certainly not least, my wife, Tanya. Stand up. Stand up, Tanya. The love of my life and my kids. Chanel, David, Ariel, stand up. You guys are my heart. I love you. I really do. Finally, I could go on and on, but I certainly am not. I know what you want to say, Kirby.
Woven throughout his 23-minute speech, his gratitude is part of his message about attitude.
You know what the secret of being the best is all about? Just giving all it is about. It's not about numbers. It's not about the money. It's about giving the best you've had. It's an inner affirmation. It's here. It's up here. You know, you can't buy it. Nobody can give it to you. You got to find it. Yeah, I've had a complete career. How could I not? I played in America's finest city, San Diego, America's greatest city, New York, perhaps North America's classiest city, Toronto. Played at home with the Minnesota Twins, Gene Autry and Anaheim. That's probably why I live in California now, and Cleveland. All everybody, thank you. You made me feel welcome. You've embraced my family. It's been a wonderful journey of personal discovery and development. I've given to baseball everything I've had, and baseball's given its best back to me today. Thank you. I love you all.
It is an experience his family will remember forever.
It is so gratifying to know that my son-in-law has reached the highest level that you can attain in baseball world. And the best part about it, he had so many glorious friends to share this moment with him.
We're just all excited about it. We've had a great time. We just love every minute of it. And we're so happy for him and proud of him at the same time.
I mean, he's my dad, so I mean, that's why he's special to me, really.
On behalf of our family, thank you to everybody who's ever been any part of my brother's life.
For a guy who awed so many, Dave Winfield himself is in awe of the legends in the Cooperstown landscape.
Wow, man, all these guys were really gracious.
David and I talk about it, that this is God touching us, no question about it, and we are enjoying every moment of it.
Dave Winfield's induction was a cause for celebration, a moment shared by baseball fans, family, and friends. It was in the summer of 2001, a month before New York City and the world was forever changed by 9/11. But at the time, his celebration and sentimental journey certainly were befitting a guy known for doing things his way and in a big way.
Dave Winfield!
He had played in a few exhibition games at Doubleday Field during his career, but in 2001, Dave Winfield joins his new Hall of Fame colleagues in a post-induction day tradition, throwing out the ceremonial first pitch. Then he's in for the ride of his life.
You're gonna go right over the city?
Whisked away on a helicopter, compliments of Hall of Fame chairman Jane Forbes Clark.
There's where the induction was.
Wow.
An hour and a half flight takes him over his old stomping grounds, Yankee Stadium.
That is awesome.
That's great.
And into Manhattan by the Empire State Building.
Where's the gorilla?
Arriving just in time for the big bash at Cipriani's, 42nd and Lexington.
Oh, man.
My man.
Good to see y'all.
Where you belong, baby?
What began as his wife's idea to be just a little family and friends gathering turns into a family, friends, and superstar guest list gala.
Go. Look at you.
Smile.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
And I looked at this big guy, because I'm not the biggest guy in the world. I said, who is this new big guy in the league? Because he never went to the minor leagues. And then we had a chance to sit down and talk. And I said, not only is he a big guy, he's also a special guy.
I got most of those rookie cards.
Oh, you got
Dave was drafted in all three big-time sports. But when he said, and I chose baseball, the way he said baseball, there was so much affection in his voice and in his timbre. He loved baseball. He loves it.
As we go back to Alaska, when you heard me mention Alaska.
He's the one guy, when people ask me now who was the best all-around player that I had a chance to play with, and his name is certainly the name on the top of the list.
You know, the Lord gives some individuals on this planet, you know, that type of talent, and then they have to come with the resolve to just blend their will with his will and make it happen. And that's what happened today.
My boys, all of them.
Albeit star-studded, the gala is also vintage Dave Winfield, because the auction.
All right, can we get 2,500?
With donated jerseys and memorabilia.
Got 3,000 in the back.
Benefits a cause the Winfield Foundation has long supported, the Boys and Girls Clubs of America.
Sold right here for $10,000.
Here, man. Good to see you.
And while it's his night to shine, he takes time to say thank you to the people who have helped him in his efforts. Corporate sponsors, volunteers, and supporters all getting hugs, handshakes, and photos to capture the moment.
No, this is good, though. Adrenaline. I'm up for this. Yeah, I'm up for this.
New York Mayor Rudy Giuliani couldn't miss sharing kudos about the former Yankee slugger.
Even though he chose to go in as a San Diego Padre, where he got his start, what's your take on that?
I think that's fine. I mean, he's been with a lot of teams, and he's made contributions to all of them. So I'll always remember him as a Yankee, because I'm a Yankee fan. But I'm also a baseball fan. He's one of those great baseball people.
Right now, I'm living one of the most wonderful times of my professional career, and I thank all of you for sharing in that and coming out tonight. Thank you.
The past earned Dave Winfield a place in the Hall of Fame. But what more would he do with that moniker? A look at this legend's efforts to preserve, illuminate, and improve the game, next on One on One. As a way to document and amplify Dave Winfield's story surrounding his induction, we had the privilege of interviewing greats in the game. Former teammates, including some who have since retired, changed uniforms, or passed away. All valuable comments to the narrative of Dave Winfield's past and his next chapters.
So, Dave Winfield, you were just inducted into baseball's Hall of Fame. What are you going to do now?
I take a vacation in about a week.
Not so fast. There are places to go, people to meet, and television shows to be on.
1 minute, we are going to be live across America.
Because those who bear the same Hall of Fame moniker have found It's not just a highly regarded reward.
It gives him a little more power in whatever he's doing. He'll never be the same after today.
Yeah, I mean, I feel that way already.
Recently inducted to the Baseball Hall of Fame, one and only Dave Winfield.
People respect you. It's like doctor, ambassador.
This is Dave Winfield.
You know, they're not focused on what you did every day. I mean, 22 years. Did you get a hit today? What'd you do for me lately, brother? You know, things like that. I don't have to worry about a slump or a period of adjustment, as I would call it. It's just, it's good stuff.
Good stuff.
Let's see, Winnie is...
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah.
Teammates.
Goodwill. Familiar territory for Dave Winfield. It's part of who he is, and part of the reason why his decision to go in as a Padre did not only bring a little more national credibility for what was then a young 30-year-old franchise, but also brought great pride in him and the team.
The one thing our organization lacks, I think, is that sense of history, that sense of somebody you can go back to and say, hey, he started here, he established himself here, and he was a great player for San Diego, and to me, he's the first everyday player that I think we could say that about.
And it was just amazing how well he could play the game. He was just so much better than most of us.
It's always been great to be able to say that I had an opportunity to play with him and learn from him.
Every time I see him anywhere, he's just got that bright big smile on his face. And he looks like he's just so thankful and so appreciative of what he's been granted.
I think it's a great thing that, you know, he thought that highly of San Diego to say, I want to go in as a Padre.
Feels like this is home to him, and we feel like he's part of the family here in San Diego.
Even athletes in other sports see how Winfield's ways, legitimized by his new title, could be adopted by younger athletes.
We need to get to have some class like Dave Winfield. You know, Dave Winfield played 22 years, and you walk down the street and you can stop him and he'll give you the time of day.
From fronting a Wheaties box to visiting the White House to being an ambassador of the game, he has grabbed hold of the opportunities and platform afforded him with a Hall of Fame title. Indeed, a busy man since his induction in the summer of 2001. As one of five Padres players with their numbers retired to date, he's recognized at major team events, but has been on hand for much more than that. For 12 years, he served as the executive vice president, senior advisor to the San Diego Padres, offering input, ideas, and leadership on the team's endeavors, including the new ballpark, reaching out to minority groups and former players, the Friar Fit fitness program for kids, building bridges with businesses and youth baseball programs to share gently used equipment. In concert with the Padres, he also helped spotlight the past.
Dave is a very important part of this museum from his first visit.
Bob Kendrick is the executive director of the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum in Kansas City.
We're talking about a guy who is already very knowledgeable about baseball history and very knowledgeable about Negro Leagues history. But I think when he made his first visit here and got a chance to walk through this museum with Buck O'Neill, that's life-changing. And even as a professional athlete who is as accomplished as Dave Winfield, one of the greatest athletes ever, yet he was too in awe of this because he understood that this is his lineage. See, when you have a sense of self, you can't help but have an appreciation for this. Once he visited here, he instantly went back to San Diego and started laying the groundwork for one of the most significant Negro League celebrations that I think have ever been put on.
For a decade, Dave Winfield invited former Negro Leagues players to be honored at a luncheon, interviewed about their baseball journeys.
Ladies and gentlemen, here's Minnie Minoso.
Then saluted in an on-field pregame ceremony. He is also credited with initiating the idea for the Major League first-year draft of 30 living Negro Leagues players in 2008. While he hoped they'd be signed to a contract for a day, he was proud of this symbolic major step.
And they drafted 30 people, 26 African Americans, 3 Latin Americans, 1 woman. People were from 80 to 102 years old. And to a person, they said it was the greatest day in baseball in their life. It's about giving back, doing something for them. Their family, it was like family, so it was a great day, and we continue that legacy. It's not over. We keep making things happen.
That next dimension, working with Major League Baseball Productions, narrating the documentary Pride and Perseverance, the story of the Negro Leagues.
The fact that black ball players could go toe-to-toe with their white contemporaries did not sit well with the Major League Commissioner, who was a staunch enforcer of segregated baseball.
On a different historic note, he has been a part of a production in cities across America with the Baseball Music Project.
San Diego, let's play ball.
So what we're really doing is telling the history of baseball through an orchestral concert with Hall of Famer Dave Winfield as the host and narrator.
I was counting on the game's deep patterns. Three strikes, three outs, three times three innings, and its deepest impulse to go out and back, to leave and to return home.
They say, Dave, I know you do a lot of things, but get out of here. You're on stage in the symphony. Are you singing or what? No. But they see me in a different light. People that I work with every day don't know that I do this.
That ain't my style, said Casey. Strike one, the umpire said.
His charisma, presence, and impressive track record make him a popular speaker.
He was also named by ESPN in 2004 as one of the top three all-round athletes in any sport in American history. He was the first professional athlete to establish a charitable foundation and has lived to help others through his charitable work. Please welcome Mr. David Winfield.
The 2013 commencement speaker at Concordia University, just a mile from where he grew up in St. Paul, Minnesota.
I grew up not different than most of you here. I had no money, had no car, had no connections, had no uncle who could open all the doors for me, had no role model, had no beaten path that someone had gone before. I said, I'm out there in the world and gotta make it. In a nutshell, that Hall of Fame life you're gonna find out, it's about being healthy, it's about being educated. It's about living the principles of your family, your church, and having a sense of community and be wise enough to give back to others when you are gone. It's about having people care about you when you're gone, leaving a legacy.
While addressing students who will venture into many careers, he uses an analogy about batting 300, succeeding 3 out of every 10 times, considered good in baseball.
Always stay positive, whatever you're doing. I used to say, I'm not in a slump. I didn't like the word, it's negative. I said, I'm in a period of adjustment. Or I'm in transition, or it's a statistically acceptable aberration. I said, what? What is this baseball player talking about? So anyway, remember that a momentary defeat, it's still a prelude to success.
His collegiate success was recognized in 2006 as part of the first class of the National College Baseball Hall of Fame in Lubbock, Texas.
And I'm just honored to be up here sharing the stage with guys just like this. Great players, great coaches, and great characters, as you've heard already.
His official website is not only current with blogs, appearances, and perspective, it shows his unique resume as an author, a radio and TV broadcaster with ESPN, business leader, and motivational speaker. He tells me being in communications stems from when he would practice words with his mother in junior high for his speech class, and becoming a good typist and writer, a foundation with a natural progression beyond baseball. As for the work of preparing and speaking, paid or not, he enjoys the energy of sharing his story and inspiring others to live their own Hall of Fame lives.
I call these Winfield's principles truly, but everybody starts with God-given ability. The next one, and this is any industry, know the rules, laws, techniques, fundamentals. If you don't, you're gonna lose. Next one, purposeful practice. We go through the certain training, you're just going through the motions. You're not getting any better. You're not prepared for when it's tough, when it's tight, when it's late in the game, when it's important. You didn't prepare for it. So you lose because you didn't prepare yourself. Next one, physical fitness. You just have to be able to get through the grind. And the last one is mental toughness.
I looked at all the people in the Hall of Fame, the guys and everything, and everybody came up differently and learned it differently and succeeded differently. But to a T, every person in there had that mental toughness. Get your behind out there. Mentally tough, you gotta get through it.
His achievements are a good fit in late 2013 for the Major League Baseball Players Association, named Special Assistant to Executive Director Tony Clark, who grew up watching number 31 in San Diego. They're working on improving relations with MLB and the fans. On a personal note, he and wife Tanya celebrate 27 years of marriage in 2015, and he loves being a dad. We first met their twins, David Jr. and Ariel, in 1999. When they went on to play youth sports, he was their coach, encouraging hustle, but making sure everyone played, everyone had fun. His only request was that when he's old, kids will come back and say, "Coach Winfield, here's what I'm doing with my life." Now the twins are at the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia. David Jr., who mostly played volleyball and basketball, is majoring in business and marketing, pursuing the entertainment industry. Ariel, a volleyball player, is majoring in cognitive science, looking to be in the world of fashion and marketing. Dave's older daughter, Lauren Chanel, is a realtor in Houston. Dave Winfield is grateful for his journey, and even years after reaching the pinnacle of success, our summation of his perspective then still applies now. Born on the day Bobby Thompson hit the home run to give the New York Giants the National League title in a playoff over the Brooklyn Dodgers in 1951, the shot heard round the world. 50 years later, Dave Winfield establishes his place in the game's history. Fate, perhaps, but as he looks ahead, he is not taking for granted what he has now, because he knows what it really took to get here.
I was a little skinny kid growing up. I didn't know what my future held. I worked extremely hard, extremely hard. I mean, I had the basis, the God-given tools and ability, but I worked really, really hard to get there. And even everything else I do in life, I've never sat back and said, "Oh, people, you should hand it to me," because people never did. Those pitchers, you think they ever gave me a fat pitch down the middle and said, "Hit it"? Shoot. I work very, very hard all my life, and I do it off the field now. I mean, I never could just sit back and just golf, tennis. I mean, yeah, I'll go to the country club or whatever, but man, I work. I work. I want my kids to have that work ethic. That's what life is all about.
Dave Winfield might not have started out wanting to be a legend, but his work ethic and talent launched him to the top. Yet even with all his fame and respect as a player and leader, he doesn't rest on his laurels. Instead, he's striving to help others achieve greatness and celebrating those who already have. I'm Jane Mitchell. Thank you for watching One on One.
For backstory content, visit 4SD.com.